Philippine President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. woos Asian businessmen in a summit in Singapore, making a pitch for the country's renewable energy sector, agriculture, and the Maharlika Investment Fund. Katrina Domingo reports.
In the face of global...
President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. flew to Singapore on his 66th birthday and lost no time in courting investors from Southeast Asia's lone first world country. Among the fruits he dangled, the Philippines' 110 million consumers, an English-speaking workforce, and optimistic growth numbers.
Our growth story is underpinned by a strong domestic demand and increasing fixed capital investment as a result of upbeat domestic activity and improved business confidence. In the face of global economic volatility, the Philippines has demonstrated remarkable resilience. We have sustained consistent GDP growth, bolstered by prudent fiscal management and monetary policy. Despite high inflation and global market instability, our economy grew by 7.6% in 2022, the fastest rate of growth recorded by our country since 1976, coincidentally in the time of my father.
In August, the Banco Central ng Pilipinas said that the Philippines' GDP could drop below the 6-7% target due to global headwinds and the impact of a string of interest rate hikes. But the National Economic and Development Authority had countered the central bank's projection, saying that the Philippines can still reach the lower range of 6-7% if the economy could grow by at least 6.6% in the second half of 2023. Marcos Jr. adds the country is looking to welcome investors, especially in the manufacturing and renewable energy sectors.
The contribution of services as against manufacturing was a little lopsided, i.e. 60%, 40%.
To attract more manufacturing companies, Marcos shares the Philippines has been trying to increase the energy supply and highlights how the country now allows a 100% foreign ownership of renewable energy projects.
Have to move the mix of fossil fuels to renewables. And so that's why we continue to court investment. We are also actively promoting investment in smart and sustainable agriculture. By investing in our nation, you invest in a greener, more sustainable, and more equitable world.
The president says opportunities also await investors in the agricultural sector as the Philippines pushes to boost its yield to veer away from the importation of food commodities.
This was one of the hardest lessons that we had to learn. We cannot now continue to depend on importation. In the past years, it became the easy way out. The pandemic showed us that this was not a wise choice. The aspiration, once again, is that we are able to provide sufficient supply of food at prices that people can afford. And that's still, we are not there yet, but we have made many important steps to start that. We are trying to put the value chain, especially of agriculture, we're trying to put that value chain together from all the way from R&D, all the way to retail, to the market.
The president also assures investors that the Philippine Sovereign Fund was designed to tame the Philippines' high debt-to-GDP ratio, which he says is pegged at 62-63%. Marcos Jr.'s guarantee, the Maharlika Fund will not be subject to the whims of politicians.
But it will be run as a fund. It is not run by the government. It is run by professional fund managers. When the politicians get involved, then the decisions are no longer purely financial in nature. That causes failure, I think.
The Filipino leader also tries to ease the business community's geopolitical worries without directly mentioning the Philippines' territorial row with China, the world's second largest economy.
Geopolitical stability and regional cooperation are cornerstones of our foreign policy. Our nation's resilience and ability to adapt are not just stories, they are lessons that we bring to the table. Lessons that we share with partners who are invested in our shared future. I invite each one of you to consider the Philippines as a strategic partner in your journey.
The palace earlier confirmed that aside from his appearance at the Milken Institute's 2023 Asia Summit, the president is expected to stay in Singapore until the weekend because he was invited by Singapore's prime minister to watch the F1 Grand Prix finals in Southeast Asia's most expensive city. Katrina Domingo, ABS-CBN News.
Four entities have purchased bid documents for the Ninoy Aquino International Airport Rehabilitation Project. Andrea Taguines reports.
Since the Philippine government opened the bidding process to rehabilitate the country's main gateway, Transportation Assistant Secretary Lionel De Veles said four parties have already expressed interest to participate.
So far, there are four parties, entities that have purchased the bidding documents. The Manila International Airport Consortium, that's number one. There was San Miguel Corporation, also purchased the bidding documents, and GMR. The fourth one, I have to confirm which one, because I just got the information.
Earlier this year, the Manila International Airport Consortium, which is composed of six Philippine conglomerates and its U.S.-based partner, also made an unsolicited proposal to rehabilitate NAIA with a 25-year concession. But the government opted for a solicited deal with a concession period of 15 years with a possible 10-year extension anchored on performance. De Veles said they aim to award the 170.6 billion peso contract by this year. NAIA has long been dubbed as one of the worst airports in the world, but calls to fix it up grew louder following at least three major power outages since January. According to the Public-Private Partnership Center, both foreign and local parties are invited to bid for the contract to rehabilitate, operate, and maintain NAIA. The project will cover all facilities of the airport, including its runways, four terminals, and associated facilities. It aims to increase the current annual airport capacity to 62 million from the current 35 million passengers, as well as increase air traffic movement. But some workers under the Airport Employees Union oppose the move. While they are not against the NAIA upgrade, they fear that its privatization could cost them their jobs.
Kami ba ay malilay off? Kami ba ay mariretrench? Ang aming pong mga empleyado ay nakakaroon po ng pagkabalisa kasi marami po sa amin ang mga nagpapaaral ng mga anak. Talaga pong ang reklamo ay valid, meron po talaga mga pagkukulang, pero naniniwala po kami na hindi po privatization ang sagot sa mga problema.
The union also warned of higher airport service fees once the project is done. But De Veles said they're looking to offset these charges by making room for more commercial spaces.
One of the things that you may notice in our airports is that the lack of leasable spaces, or at least commercial areas, food and beverage options, these are usually what helps offset the increases in passenger service charge.
De Veles also stressed the importance of developing other airports in the Philippines to boost the tourism industry.
One of our key drivers of the economy is tourism. We can't just develop our tourism sector in a bubble. We have to consider that there are competing countries, Malaysia, Thailand, Vietnam. These countries are investing in their airports.
Apart from NAIA, the DOTR has also sought the private sector's help in developing regional airports like the Puerto Princesa International Airport in Palawan and the Calibo International Airport, which is a gateway to the Paradise Island of Boracay. Andrea Taguines, ABS-CBN News.
Top Philippine and U.S. officials inspect projects at EDCA sites in the provinces of Cagayan and Pampanga. These include the Alalno Airport and the Naval Base Camilo Oceais in Cagayan and the Basa Airspace in Pampanga. The officials assess the potential of the sites, which will be used to support humanitarian assistance and disaster response operations.
The projects that were selected were designed to be able to do immediate response for humanitarian assistance, just like we did, but in a more robust way. Runway, you know, broadened, humanitarian assistance warehouse. Those capabilities are specifically designed to do that, to increase our ability to exercise together.
Philippine Armed Forces Chief General Romeo Bronner Jr. meanwhile vowed to closely monitor all EDCA projects.
We're still in the planning process, so we have to make sure that all the the money that we're going to spend here are worth it. We're not just looking at how we can operate together more efficiently, but also we're looking at the future operations that we are going to conduct.
The Philippines and the U.S. are also set to conduct a mutual defense meeting Thursday, where they are expected to discuss key security issues for both countries. The visit to the EDCA sites comes on the heels of growing maritime tensions between the Philippines and China and the West Philippine Sea. Philippine Defense Secretary Gilbert Jodoro defends the country's security partnership with the U.S. Jodoro spoke after Senator Robin Padilla criticized what he considers as the Philippine government's over-reliance on foreign forces during a recent resupply mission to the Philippine Navy's outpost at the Ayungan Shoal. Jodoro explains there is a need to leverage Manila's allies due to the changing threat situation and China's aggressive actions in the West Philippine Sea. The defense chief also dismissed as Beijing's propaganda that the Philippines is being reeled into a proxy war by aligning with the U.S. and other countries competing with China.
Internal threats have waned significantly. But nevertheless, Your Honor, the intensity of the need to focus on protecting our sovereignty, our sovereign rights, in the exclusive economic zone and other jurisdictions of the country become more paramount now as the whole world is in a race for resources.
Secretary Jodoro also justifying government's allocation of confidential funds to civilian agencies. Jodoro said civilian agencies use confidential funds for anti-criminality campaigns.
The best way to probably weaken a country is rather than an overt warlike function or disruption of your facilities is really to take control of your internal economy, internal processes, and the like. Yun po, kinakailangan din po ng intelligence and confidential funds ng different agencies para ho mabantayan at masugpo ito.
The latest civilian agency to request confidential funds is the Department of Information and Communications Technology. The DICT is seeking 300 million pesos in confidential funding for next year. DICT Secretary Ivan Uy said the funds are essential for their intelligence operations against online scammers.